Shock control testing is performed to assess whether an object can survive shock loads from an explosive event or a collision. There are two main types of shock control testing: classic shock and shock using a shock response analysis and a shock response synthesis. This video will talk about the latter. Suppose you want to perform a high-level shock test and the maximum acceleration exceeds the shaker limit. In that case, we can use SRA and SRS in test lab to determine another time signal with lower max amplitude that has the same damage potential as the original shock. The process is as follows. First, measure the shock profile. This will be an acceleration versus time signal. Next, we're going to do a shock response analysis, which will derive the shock response spectrum from that time data. We'll be moving from the time domain to the frequency domain. There's only one shock response spectrum for each time signal, so it's a unique solution. The next step will be shock response synthesis. This is the step where we'll derive the time signal with lower max amplitude but equivalent damage. There are an infinite number of solutions when we're going from the frequency domain with our shock response spectrum to the time domain to generate that waveform. As I said, there are infinite solutions to this problem, so we'll iterate until we find a solution that fits within the limits of our shaker. Let's work on performing those steps. Here I am in Simcenter Test Lab Shock Control. The first step was to measure the shock profile with an acceleration versus time signal. That's what we have here. You can see that the maximum amplitude of this shock is about 50 G, which is above our shaker limitations, which has a maximum acceleration limit of 30 Gs. So first, we need to do the shock response analysis and derive the shock response spectrum. To do that, I'm simply going to work in the navigator, select your time trace, and then use this SRS button, which will calculate a shock response spectrum. I'll leave the values at the defaults. If you want more information about these values, check out our shock response spectrum article. Now we have the shock response spectrum, which has been saved away into our project automatically when we calculated it. So let's go into the shock setup workbook. In the shock setup workbook, we're going to come here into our profile editor area. Here, where it says classical, we're going to drop down and do SRS instead. Enter the profile editor. And on this first tab of the profile editor, this is where we specify our target shock response spectrum. You can either manually type the values for the frequency and the amplitude into the table, but it's more common to just import a block. So I'll click Select SRS Block, and I'll browse to it on my PC. A preview of the spectrum will appear in the lower left window. We'll just have to ensure that the minimum and maximum frequency match the imported spectrum. Now I'm going to move into the time synthesis tab. In time synthesis, it's possible to create your synthesized waveform by using a combination of either wavelets, damped signs, or chirps. All three of these waveforms are simply component waveforms characterized by narrowband frequency content in the frequency domain. I'll leave it at the default of wavelet. I'll hit the default button for our default solution, and this will serve as the starting point for the iterative process. You can see that we are still not meeting the shaker limitations. This area here is the indicator of whether we have met or exceeded our shaker limitations. You can see that for acceleration and displacement, these boxes are red, indicating that we are outside of the shaker limitations. I'll iterate on the profile, and now you can see that the SRS is fairly close to the target, and we are within all of the shaker limitations. So that's it. That's all there is to it, to calculating a time pulse with the equivalent damage that will fit within your shaker limitations.